Good evening. Good evening and welcome to the Missouri History Museum. I welcome both those with us in the auditorium tonight and those online with our live stream. Thank you for joining us for this important and timely community conversation. The Missouri History Museum has shown commitment to hosting conversations of the sort for some time and had our guest plan tonight to talk about the Trayvon Martin case. And unfortunately, in a turn, her subtitle became more important to us tonight, and that is why we continue to repeat it. And to answer that why, we've developed a panel tonight to speak to different perspectives, to address it from their respective areas, but also to hear from you. We will have a Q&A portion for the evening that's both with microphones and note cards, and we want to make sure to hear from you. But our panel will join us first to share their thoughts. Our guest tonight is the author of Suspicion Nation, Why We Continue to Repeat It. And the book will be for sale at a table outside of the auditorium. And then also she'll be visiting with those guests who are attending the reception tonight. You won't have cell phone service in the auditorium, but there is access to our Wi-Fi. And for those who continue in Twitter chats or engage in that method, that would be the Mo History Museum. That is our handle on Twitter tonight. These programs are not possible without the support of our community through our membership. And if you believe in continuing these kinds of conversations and making space for them, I do also extend the offer to you tonight to join us in that. To join us in the membership. We are responsive to community concerns in our programming, in our guest speakers. And our partnership makes most of the programs possible as well. And so to introduce our speaker tonight, I'd like to bring up the founder of Meet Me St. Louis, who partnered and brought Lisa Bloom to us this evening. Marcia.
Thank you, Alex. My name is Marcia Evers-Levy, and I am the founder and president of Meet Me St. Louis. It's a new not-for-profit organization that brings exciting and educational authors and speakers right here to St. Louis for events and community programs such as this. We are honored to have brought Lisa Bloom and this program to our community. We're also very grateful for the partnership and support of the Anti-Defamation League, the Diversity Awareness Partnership, NCCJ St. Louis, and of course, the Missouri History Museum. In addition, we want to thank the more than 25 co-sponsoring community organizations who came out and shared their information tonight at the tables up in the Grand Hall. I hope you were all able to visit with them and found ways to get involved and make a difference in our community. Let me introduce our featured speaker and the moderator for this evening's discussion. Lisa Bloom is a civil rights lawyer and the legal analyst for NBC News, appearing frequently on the Today Show as well as on CNN, HLN, and MSNBC. An award-winning TV legal expert, Lisa is one of the most sought-after voices in American law, making thousands of broadcast appearances over the last decade, covering every major crime or trial story in the United States, including the Michael Brown shooting in Ferguson. Lisa is also a New York Times best-selling author whose latest book is entitled Suspicion Nation, The Inside Story of the Trayvon Martin Injustice and Why We Continue to Repeat It. Please welcome Lisa Bloom.
Hello, friends, community members, fellow children of God. I already knew I loved St. Louis, but I love St. Louis even more when this many people come out for a book event on a night when I hear there is some kind of sporting event also going on that affects your town. I'm very pleased that you're all here tonight to talk with us about the important issues. I want to emphasize there will be a Q&A afterwards, and we want to hear from all of the voices at that time. I was invited, I think back in March, to come and speak tonight, and that was because of my book, Suspicion Nation, which came out in February. And let me talk to you briefly about that book and how it came into being and why I became so passionate about these issues and how I think it pertains to St. Louis today. I'm a civil rights lawyer. I have a civil rights practice in Los Angeles and New York, and I try cases involving excessive force, race discrimination, sexual harassment, LGBT rights, you name it. And I've been doing that for a long time, since about 1986, and I also do a lot of television, as Marcia indicated. Last year, NBC News asked me to cover the George Zimmerman trial, gavel to gavel, that is, watch the whole thing on a television feed, comment on it throughout the day on MSNBC and do all of the NBC shows and talk about it basically nonstop throughout the day. And I did that, and I came to the case with an open mind, because while our criminal justice system has many flaws, the requirement of proof beyond a reasonable doubt is not one of them. Show me the evidence. I wanted to see the evidence in this case or in any case, because we have a problem in America with mass incarceration. We have a problem in America with innocent people being convicted. And as much as I didn't think it looked good for George Zimmerman going into the trial, I wanted to see the evidence. Well, initially, in that three-week trial, I thought the evidence was not coming in particularly well for the prosecution. I thought they just didn't really have much in the way of evidence, and their witnesses weren't too good. And then I had my aha moment in that case, and that was a couple weeks into the trial when I reviewed the evidence myself at night, as I would if I were trying the case myself. Because, of course, a good trial lawyer, you're going to look at that evidence over and over. You don't just look at it once. You don't just look at it twice. You look at it over and over. You bring in other eyes to look at it. And I saw something that was very important, and that is that George Zimmerman indicated on videotape the day after the shooting where his gun was holstered. And he indicated very clearly three times on a videotape that the gun was holstered behind him. Behind him, inside the waistband of his pants. And in fact, that's where the holster manufacturer recommended that holster be worn, behind the wearer. This became extremely important to me because George Zimmerman's story was that he was down flat on his back, that Trayvon Martin was on top of him, knees to elbows, that Trayvon saw the gun, reached for the gun, and George Zimmerman had no alternative at that moment but to pull the gun and shoot in self-defense to save his life. Well, if you put together all of the facts of the case, unless Trayvon Martin had X-ray vision, there is no way he saw that gun. He could not have seen through the bulk of George Zimmerman's body. When you add to the fact that it was a very dark night, according to all witnesses, it was raining and there was a grassy ground cover, that the gun was matte black, that is, not shiny, that the holster was matte black, George Zimmerman, his story was clearly a lie. Well, I was very disturbed when I noticed this in the videotape, and you know, it's one of those cases where I couldn't believe my own eyes. I had to make other people look at it, and they saw the same thing. And then I became even more disturbed when I noticed the prosecutors were not arguing this in the courtroom. The prosecutors had not argued. And in fact, the defense attorneys were demonstrating the gun like this. They were demonstrating the gun was holstered in the front. And the prosecutors were not objecting. So by the time closing argument came around, I was getting very suspicious about what was going on in that courtroom. It seemed to me that witnesses were not prepared. It seemed to me that expert witnesses who should have been called were not being called. And in closing argument, the prosecution gave this long, rambling, disjointed closing argument that was essentially a series of questions. Well, as any good trial lawyer knows, questions equal reasonable doubt. And so I said on the air prior to the verdict that when both sides are arguing reasonable doubt, there's only one possible verdict, and that is acquittal. And that's exactly what happened. So let me be clear. I don't blame the jurors. I have a lot of information in my book Inside the Jury Room about what happened, especially to Maddie, the only juror of color in that case, some really shocking stuff. But I do blame the professionals in the courtroom. And so after that case was over, I decided I needed to know more. I was not ready to be done. I needed to know what happened. This was the trial of the year. This is a trial that we all watched. And yet, what we were seeing was very disturbing to me. And so I went and I interviewed key witnesses like Rachel Gentile. She was the young woman who was on the phone with Trayvon Martin, because I suspected she had not been prepared. And guess what? She was not prepared. And I talk in the book about how trial lawyers, how we do prepare a young person who's nervous and scared, as practically everybody is, before they take the witness stand, how you do prepare somebody like that. And she wasn't prepared. I talk about expert witnesses who were begging to take the stand to contradict the ridiculous theories offered by the defense expert witness, and that person was not allowed to testify. I talk about cross-examinations that were done of this very defense expert witness, Dr. Vincent DiMaio, in other cases where he was completely eviscerated, and it didn't happen in this case. So putting it all together, I get the million-dollar question, which is, did they do it intentionally? Or was this negligence? I call this the blow it or throw it question. Did the prosecution blow it intentionally, or did they throw the case? I leave that to you, my dear readers, to come to your own conclusion about that. I will say that Angela Corey, who was the lead prosecutor in the case, right after her team lost, had a big smile for the cameras and said the system worked. It was a very disturbing outcome. Now, what are the lessons for Ferguson and for St. Louis? Because, as I say, the subtitle of my book is The Inside Story of the Trayvon Martin Injustice and Why We Continue to Repeat It. And oh, how I wish I were wrong about that. Of course, Trayvon Martin was not the first, and Michael Brown was not the last. But let me talk to you from my wheelhouse, something I know about, and that is the law and how trial lawyers operate. There are many wonderful people in this community doing good work in their nonviolent protests, raising awareness, making historic, in my opinion, historic gains in this country. But I want to talk to you from the point of view of the law. I believe that we are making some of the very same mistakes in this case that were made in the Trayvon Martin, the George Zimmerman case. Now, I want to emphasize, we are only really at the beginning, at least I hope we are at the beginning, of a prosecution in the Darren Wilson case. And since so much has gone on behind closed doors, I can't fully assess it the way that I did in the George Zimmerman case, where I had everything laid out before me and I was able to pore over it for months and talk to people and really get the full story to write my book. But here are my concerns. When tens of thousands of people in the community sign a petition that they don't trust you, it's time to recuse yourself. Thank you. You know, we have a concept in the law called the appearance of impropriety. The appearance of impropriety. And that means when a judge or a public official has the appearance, they maybe didn't even have to actually do anything wrong, but then when they appear to not be the right person to hear that case or to try that case, they step aside. Why? Because the appearance is important. Public perception is important. That's number one. Number two, when you have six eyewitnesses who say a young man had his hands up in the air and the universal sign of surrender at the time that he was fatally shot, that is probable cause, and you can file charges yourself, and you should. Six witnesses. I wish I had six witnesses in my trial, any trial I've got. I've got one coming up in a couple weeks. I wish I had six witnesses on the key issue in the case who all agree on the most important thing. Let me tell you, as a trial lawyer, that is rare. In fact, I'd say in my 28 years, I don't think I've ever had that in any of my cases. Six witnesses? Are you kidding me? What more do you need? Okay, so I think the appropriate thing in this case would have been to file charges directly, take the matter to a preliminary hearing, which is normally a one-day affair, and which is public. Why are we hiding behind a secret grand jury proceeding? A proceeding that is completely confidential, that goes one day a week for months and months, and drags this thing out. Now, we know, I usually represent plaintiffs in civil cases, a prosecutor has a similar role. We have the burden of proof, right? We have to prove it beyond a reasonable doubt in a criminal case. In my civil cases, it's a preponderance of the evidence. We have the burden of proof. What does that mean? It means I need good witnesses. I need witnesses whose memories are fresh. I need a short period of time as possible to pass between the incident and the trial. Delays help the defense. Why choose a system that is not only secretive, but that is glacially slow? And the final concern I have about this grand jury proceeding is, and this is so similar to the George Zimmerman case, is this theory that, you know, we're going to dump everything on the grand jury and we're going to let them decide. Now, that may sound, for those who are not familiar with the system, like, you know, it sounds fair, we're going to put it all out there, let them decide. But I'm here to tell you that is just not the way it usually works. At trial, yes, all of the evidence will come out. But I will say that at the George Zimmerman trial, that's what the prosecutor said. So after Angela Corey had that big smile and she said the system worked, she said, because we put all of the evidence out there and now America can decide. Well, that's actually not the job of the prosecutor. They're not documentary filmmakers. They're not journalists. Their job isn't to just put it all out there and now everybody can see it. Their job is to be an advocate for the victim. And yes, they are supposed to introduce exculpatory evidence, evidence that helps the defense, that is an ethical role that they have. But the job of a prosecutor is to give a jury a roadmap to conviction, to review the evidence in this case, and to come to a conclusion about what the appropriate charges are. And to simply put it all out there one day a week for months and months conveys one unmistakable message, I think, to the grand jury, and that is, boy, this is a tough case. This is a complicated, confusing case with a lot of evidence. I don't know, you know, I'm the only representatives of the justice system in that jury room, but I sure can't figure it out. I hope you jurors can, even though you're not lawyers. I hope you can connect some of these long, confusing facts to the law. I hope you can come up with something. That's the same message that I believe that was conveyed in the George Zimmerman trial, which is a message of reasonable doubt, or in this case, no indictment. Now, I can't be sure. Am I sure to a 100% certainty of what I'm saying tonight? No, I'm not in that jury room. I can't be sure. But I'm talking about danger signs. I'm talking about similarities that I see, that I saw in the George Zimmerman case, and that I am seeing here tonight. And I'm very concerned. I'm concerned about the lack of process, the lack of transparency, and what's going on here. So the first half of my book, Suspicion Nation, which of course I hope you will all read, is a recounting of the six huge errors that were made by the prosecution in that case. Rookie mistakes, really, most of them. The second half is why we continue to repeat it. Why we see these cases over and over again. And each time we're so shocked, and of course we're horrified, and of course the community and the family is traumatized. But we as a nation are so shocked, and then we move on, we kind of forget about it, and then another one happens, and then we're shocked, and then we forget about it. So why does this continue to happen? Well, there are a number of reasons, and I don't have time to go into all of them, but I want to talk about what I think is the most important one, and that's the issue of implicit racial bias. And how many people, by the way, have heard the phrase implicit racial bias or have some familiarity with it? Well, aren't you an educated bunch? Good. I'm glad to hear that. Implicit racial bias is something that I had the opportunity to learn about both in talking about the George Zimmerman case and writing about it, and I did a great deal of research on it because it seems to me to be the explanation. I did a radio show this morning where the host kept saying, you know, I'm not racist, and then he would say a lot of things that probably some of us would think were racist, right? And so, you know, is he just confused? Is he self-deluded? You know, what's going on here? I think the answer is implicit racial bias. So if you'll bear with me, I want to read you just a couple of pages from my book about that, and then we're going to have the panel come up. First of all, I talk about the Dahl studies. So many of you might know in Brown versus Board of Education, 1954, probably the most important case in Supreme Court history, in my opinion, the case relied upon the Dahl study. What were the Dahl studies? Little African-American children were shown a white doll, shown a black doll, and they were asked, which is the good doll? And they would point to the white doll. Which is the pretty doll? They would point to the white doll. Which is the bad doll? And they would point to the black doll, the one that looked just like them. You know, it was such a heartbreak, that study, and it led to that sweeping US Supreme Court decision in Brown versus Board of Education. Well, cut to about 60 years later, just a couple years ago, the same study was replicated in Harlem with the same results. So why is it that little children, these were preschoolers, 4 or 5 years old, they've already internalized the racism in our culture to such an extent that they point to the black doll as the one that's bad and ugly and evil? I think a lot of that has to do with our culture's messages about African Americans and implicit racial bias. Implicit bias against those with darker skin goes beyond children's assessments of good and bad and adult decisions on physical allure and dating. More perniciously, we are quicker to see aggressiveness and violence in African Americans, even when whites engage in identical behavior. For example, in one study, 75% of whites observing a black person shoving a white person called the behavior violent, but only 17% characterized the identical act performed by a white person shoving a black person as violent. Many called the latter simply playing around. Both black and white subjects are more likely to rate computer-generated African-American faces as hostile compared to identical, except for skin color, white faces. The stereotype that blacks are criminals, dangerous, violent, runs deep. We are so quick to assume that African-American men are suspicious that many of us see weapons in their hands when there are none, for example. In another study, participants were shown a face than an object. They were more likely to misidentify a non-threatening object as threatening when a black face preceded it. And they were more likely to mistake a dangerous item as safe when a white face preceded it. "He's got his hand in his waistband," Zimmerman said to the police dispatcher of Trayvon Martin, "and he's a black male." A moment later, he added, "He's got something in his hands." What Zimmerman saw as suspicious was probably a cell phone. Many Americans, including police officers, make the same mistake Zimmerman did, magically seeing a weapon in the hands of an unarmed black male. Social psychologists at the University of Colorado asked subjects to watch a video and then make a split-second decision to shoot when they perceived that the character who flashed on the screen threatened them. In experiment after experiment, the subjects were undergraduates, DMV customers, mall food court patrons, and police officers. Mistakes followed a pattern. They shot more unarmed blacks than unarmed whites, and they failed to shoot more whites than blacks who were holding weapons. Recounting the results of four separate studies, researchers wrote, "In the case of African-American targets, participants simply set a lower threshold for the decision to shoot." That trend held true even when the participants themselves were African-American. All of these subconscious conclusions that African-Americans are violent or armed or worthy of more severe treatment have profound implications for a criminal justice system in which deciding who was aggressive in the high-pressure confrontation is a monumental determination. So many decisions of police and prosecutors, judges and juries turn on gut assessments of who provoked a street fight, who pulled a weapon first, who verbally threatened the other, whether a victim appeared to be reaching in his waistband for a gun, or was it just Skittles? And all those players in the criminal justice system have the same unacknowledged racial biases as the rest of 21st century America, affecting their perceptions, while at the same time, most would strongly reject the idea that prejudice had any role at all in their judgments. And here's the key. Most of us think that one is either racist or one is not, and certainly that we are not. An accusation of racism is a serious charge and is usually hotly denied. And yet the field of testing for implicit bias opens up a third option, that while we would like to think of ourselves as open-minded and egalitarian, most of us have subliminally absorbed long-standing and widespread cultural messages that affect our decision-making processes when it comes to sizing up African Americans. And so racial bias festers perniciously under the smooth surface where no one admits to prejudice at all. I believe this is the problem. I talk in the book about the implicit bias test, which I took, which we can all take online for free. It takes about 15 minutes. I have the link in my book. And it's an eye-opening experience. About 75% of whites test for moderate or severe racial bias against African Americans, and about 50% of African Americans do too. That is, test for moderate or severe racial bias against their own group. And I've spoken all over the country about my book. When I do, when I speak to a white audience or a predominantly white audience, people usually say, "Wow, really? I didn't know that." When I speak to a black audience, people go, "Mm-hmm." So there's a lot of things that some of us know and others of us don't know. And I think that's that's one of them. You know, it's a tough issue, but Martin Luther King said on his last night when he spoke to the sanitation workers, the night before he was shot unarmed by a white shooter in America, he said, "All we say to America is be true to what you said on paper." The good news in America today is that many of us care deeply about equality. Certainly, I think everybody in this room does, that we are all here to advance ourselves towards equality. There are solutions. I have other solutions in my book that I can talk about, but I believe digging down deep into our own racial biases is a big part of the answer. It's very easy to demonize someone like George Zimmerman or Darren Wilson, and I believe they should be demonized. But it is much harder. But it is much harder to look in the mirror at what our own part of this is and what we can do to be part of the solution. So thank you very much. We have a wonderful panel. Enough about me. We have a wonderful panel, and I'd like you all to please come on up and take a seat now. And I'm going to ask each member of the panel, after they settle in, to please introduce himself or herself. Briefly and without modesty, as I say to my expert witnesses, tell us who you are, don't be shy, don't hold back, and then if you would be so kind as to give us just your take from your perspective about the events in St. Louis of the last couple months. Let's start with Karen. Okay. Anthony, you want to try yours? No? All right. Do we have a sound person in the house?
I can yell.
Is that check better? 1, 2.
Ah, how do you like that? All right. Karen?
Good evening, everybody. My name is Karen Oresti. I'm the regional director of the Anti-Defamation League for Missouri and Southern Illinois. I also am very much attached to the second part of the title of the book, Why We Repeat It, because in my concern, which is very much about education and advocacy, I see the shooting as certainly an aspect of policing that needs to be addressed specifically. But it's pretty clear that this has opened up an enormous discussion about what I refer to as the structure of racism in this community. And it's hard because it exists on so many levels. But the three that we look at most carefully are public policies and laws, institutional practices, and then that personal bias piece. And very much in sync with what Lisa said about implicit bias, on the table, we just all have it. Half the time, we're completely unaware of how it plays out. But when you look at the capacity of the structure of laws in this country, of the institutional practices that support it, and then you add in the bias piece, it becomes a very difficult thing to overturn. That said, I think the events of Ferguson and the conversations that are going on right now here and all over the region provide us with a spectacular opportunity to be able to decide how each of us here and beyond is going to play in to do something about that.
Thank you. You had it a minute ago.
Check 1, 2.
Yeah.
Hi, welcome back.
Thank you.
My name is Steve Runge, and I am the chief of police in Charlac, Missouri. Many of you that travel up and down Interstate 170 might be familiar with where we sit. I see a thumbs down. I've gotten rid of that camera, my friend. It's all gone. I don't see any other police officers in here. I told Raul I felt like I was at the Last Supper. But again, my name is Steve Runge, and I'm the chief of police in Charlac, Missouri, and I've been a police officer 25 years. I've stepped out of law enforcement for about 8 years, and I got into radio. I'm a sportscaster when I put on my other hat out in the Westplex area. Got into police work back in April. And I just want to share with you my welcome back to law enforcement, other than this, what's going on in Ferguson. My very first day at Charlac, we, very small department, I stood out on our back porch, which neighbors a side street, and a school bus came down the street with kindergartners on it. And I'm out there smiling like the Cheshire Cat, waving at all these kids. And out of the back of the bus, I hear, F the police. And I go, wow. And then I drive around town, and the Charlac is a very diverse community. And I notice that neither the African-American nor the white kids make any eye contact with the police. I would wave at the kids, and they wouldn't even look at me to wave back. Prior to me getting there, I don't know if you may recall, my police department had black cars with tinted windows. They didn't even see, you couldn't see if a police officer was waving at you. So my immediate response was, how do these people know that we're friendly when they can't even see us? So I got rid of all the black cars with the tinted windows. We also wore the tactical uniforms. Have you guys seen those uniforms among some of the departments? They look like Tackleberry from the police academy. Some of you young kids, it's probably in your history book if you want to look that up. But they look like Tackleberry from the police academy, not approachable. They had the cargo pockets and all the tactical black and the black glasses and the black gloves and the black hats. And they get out of black cars with tinted windows. That is not my style of policing. And I immediately got rid of all of that. I moved from Troy, Missouri, which is out in the sticks, to... I still have all my teeth, so it doesn't look like I'm from Lincoln County, does it? But I moved the day of the shooting. I love you, Troy. The day of the shooting, I pulled up to Florissant, Missouri with a moving truck. And I got called out to the shooting. And I spent that night there, not as a police chief, but as a first responder. I was at Canfield in West Florissant when the crowd first started to gather, before there was even a crowd. Before the riots began, I was there. I left there probably about 10 or 11 o'clock at night, and the tensions were simply insane. I responded back out the following night. I was at the command post at the Target at Buzz West Falls Shopping Center. I responded there as the riots began at West Florissant and Chambers Road, all the way on the western part of the town. I stayed there till about 2 in the morning. I was there to the point to where we ourselves were surrounded by rioters. There were 6 of us at the command post. At that time, the command post consisted of the hood of a Ford Taurus and a map and as much as we could gather, because as fast as we were getting police officers to the shopping center so that we could deploy them, calls for emergencies were just off the charts with shootings, officers in need of aid, robberies, burglaries in progress, looting. They burned down the Quick Trip. People said, why didn't you go in there to stop that? We couldn't. The fire department wouldn't go. They had to be until we could make it safe. So a lot of things were crazy that night. We had 500 police officers running from West Florissant and Chambers to beyond West Florissant and Lucas and Hunt, and we still couldn't keep up with it. So that was a crazy night. I felt, they shot at us, they shot at each other, they shot at the helicopter, anything that moved. I stayed up there for 2 weeks after that at the command post, not as a decision maker. I want to make that clear. I was simply a first responder. I was a first responder there to unload trucks, help out in any way that I could. But I was able to see as everything transformed from a very violent and tumultuous situation to more. I was there throughout the peaceful demonstrations to where they shut it down. My department still remains active as part of the solution. As Lisa pointed out, I'm here. I'm the only police officer here. I would like to have seen more. But I did reach out to the Diversity Awareness Partnership. I've attended some of their training. I reached out to the NAACP. I met with Mike McMillan from the Urban League. My city has implemented the amnesty program for warrants to get rid of some of those warrants. And I am here. I'm not going to talk too much, but I am here to listen. What you have to say means a lot to me, because I'm going to take that information back to my town and share it with some area police chiefs. And so I'm here to learn more than I am to talk. But thank you.
Well, thank you, Steve. I have a suggestion for what we can do with that camera. We can talk about badge cams and dashboard cams in just a moment. But Raul, let's hear from you.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Raul Reyes. I'm an attorney in New York City. I'm also a journalist, and I'm a contributor with NBCNews.com and MSNBC. I grew up in Southern California, and I'm in New York now. So I want to preface my remarks by saying I am here in your community very humbly as someone from the outside. And I've watched some of these developments, and I've watched this case unfold, and it's a very emotional thing for me. I grew up on the east side of Los Angeles, which is, most people, if you're from there, know is the Mexican side of town. So many of the same issues, even back in the day that we had, are still going on, only now it's in St. Louis. And one thing that is so troubling to me is that I recently saw a poll where they polled a broad cross-section of Americans. Now, they asked black, white, and Hispanic people what they thought of the Michael Brown case. It wasn't a big surprise that African Americans were following the case much more closely than white Americans, and that it resonated with them much more. But I was so taken aback and surprised that among Latinos, only 18% of Latinos said that we are following this case closely. And that infuriated me, because the same issues that are occurring in the African American communities, those are the same issues that we have in our Latino communities, whether it's mass incarceration, racial profiling, and profiling for us is made worse by the ongoing immigration debate, police brutality and allegations of police brutality. So when I look at this case and what is now becoming a type of phenomenon, news phenomenon here, I get very emotional, because I hope people look at this, including my fellow Latinos. This is not a black issue. This is a Latino issue, this is an American issue, and we have to keep that in our hearts. And something that Lisa touched on, when we look at what's going on in the case right now, Lisa is a master, I can tell you, at the legal analysis. I thought I followed the Trayvon Martin case pretty closely, and I'm halfway through her book, and there are so many revelations in it. But something that really has struck me about this case here with Michael Brown is the grand jury process. And just to set aside all the legal strategy and the legal terminology, just think, for example, if you happen to be one of those witnesses, or if you were there on the scene, the sooner that you can go to the grand jury and talk to them, the better your memory is going to be. And the more time that goes on, we're all human, maybe you just decide, I don't want to get involved in this case. Or maybe you just sort of fall out of touch. Maybe you move. Maybe you just change your mind and say, this is too big. I don't want to get my life derailed by all of this, even if it's in the name of justice. And that happens. We're all people. So when I see this grand jury process dragging on and dragging on, that means people's memories are fading. That means there's a danger of witnesses drifting away. And that there is a real risk there of the case being lost already, of not getting an indictment. And Lisa is absolutely right when she says, normally I try to avoid, when we're talking about the law, generalizations, but she is absolutely right when she says that delays favor the defense. We're all human, our minds are human, we can only remember so much, and particularly with the glare, the national spotlight that St. Louis is now receiving, you would have to be really committed as a civic-minded person to stick with it and give your testimony and appear and expose yourself to the grand jury. So that is very troubling and very worrisome to me, even at this early stage. There's so much we still don't know. But in spite of it all, I'll tell you, I'm an optimist. I believe in our law enforcement. I believe in our government. I'm very proud of Officer Runji for being here tonight. This is a brave man to come out. This type of talk, we don't know who our audience is going to be. So I think as long as we keep our focus on the search for the truth, the evidence, then we can achieve the justice that we all so long for.
Thank you so much, Raul. Anthony Gray, I'm so glad you're here. Go ahead.
Thank you. My name is Anthony Gray. Good evening, everyone. I'm born and raised in St. Louis, so I'm an Aborigine from this area, actually. So, you know, one thing I want to disabuse anybody of right off the top is that somehow my representation of the Brown family and those that are advocating for justice on their behalf are anti-police. That has just been a constant criticism, it seems like, we're constantly or consistently catching. I want you to know on behalf of myself, and I can safely say this on behalf of the family, we are not anti-police, we're not anti-government. We are against this police officer related to this incident on this day related to this individual, okay? I just wanna make sure that I establish that right off the bat, and to prove it as reinforcement, at least for myself, I always kind of give a little background about myself, so because people don't know, they like, who are you? But I've served my community. I see a good friend of mine. I thought I saw him. Pete is in the background. Pete and I, hey Pete, we served in the United States Marine Corps together. So I served my country. I also wore the same uniform that Mr. Runke has on now. I didn't have on a white shirt, but had on a blue one. But I serve my community. I serve the St. Louis community, actually. Currently, I sit as a prosecutor as we speak. I'm a municipal judge as we talk right now. So I am not anti-government. I represent justice. And sometimes that means, thank you, I receive that. And sometimes that means you represent cops and you represent robbers. So I represent anybody that has had an injustice. And in this case, Michael Brown Jr., we believe, suffered a grave injustice. And yeah. And some of the tensions that you see poured out in the street and some of the demonstrations that you see, I often say they've always have been there. They've been laying dormant in St. Louis. It really just took a cataclysmic episode like this shooting to bring it out. All of us have things in us that it takes a certain trigger to bring it out of us. So some of the racial divide and some of these differences and things that we've been fighting in St. Louis have always been there. And to me personally, I don't think it could have happened, and this is gonna sound really crazy to a lot of people, but I don't think it could have happened in a better place. And I'm gonna tell you why. Yeah, I think St. Louis is well positioned. I think is uniquely qualified to deal with a hot button issue like this. I practice law with Caucasians, and I have, you know, you always hear this phrase, I have a lot of Caucasian friends. But, you know, and it just never ceases to amaze, I mean, good, solid people to their core. And I look at that and I see, you know, of course I have African-American friends as well. Good, solid people to their core. And when they say we have diversity here, we have it like I've never seen any place else. We have major problems like we don't see in any place else either, but we are uniquely positioned to deal with it. So when the world spotlight got on St. Louis and the international attention was focused right in Ferguson, I looked at it as an opportunity, not for me personally, but for the city of St. Louis, for the St. Louis County region, for the state of Missouri, for where I'm from. And that's the way I'm taking to this case. And that's why I'm pleased to be on this panel and have this discussion, because I know we got smart people out there. I've heard your voices, and I know we got some real deep, deep-seated bigotry. And on the flip side, we got some folks that are just all the way off to the far left in their thinking too. We're gonna have that in any family. But I like to always appeal to the middle of the road, that reasonable-minded person. And when I talk to that individual, we always seem to be able to walk away with an understanding. And so I'm hoping tonight that we have in the audience those that are reasonable minded, that are prepared to just kind of listen to both sides, willing to adjust whatever position you are based on what you hear. And so that's the reason why I'm here. But let me just say this about the case, and because you asked a question about the repeater. I want everybody to know one thing about the prosecution and grand jury process. Whatever comes out of it is going to be a direct reflection of what the prosecutors present.
Yep.
Period. Yes. Period. Yes. If they don't indict, that means they didn't present the evidence to indict. If they do indict, that means they presented evidence for the indictment. Don't be fooled by the concept of this grand jury having this case as though the prosecutors are not the ones that are influencing it. And they can say they put all the evidence they want in front of the grand jury. What we'll know is what was put there, but we won't know how it was put there. The inflection in the voices and how this evidence was presented, that's under the prosecutor's control. The other day, and I'm just going to say this as a tidbit, as I was looking at the news and they said Darren Wilson didn't appear for the one drug case, the one he got the award for, the video we keep seeing looped, where he get this award from the city council, that case, he didn't appear on it. And I was sitting in bed and I was about 5 a.m, it hit me. There's your conflict. There's your conflict. Why? Because if he's indicted, he's never going to appear for that case. Not only is he not going to appear for that case, he's not going to appear for any case the prosecutor is currently prosecuting. And what does it do if he's indicted? It may open up all cases that that prosecutor's office has prosecuted. So to me, there's this appearance that you talked about earlier of impropriety because you have a vested interest now in the outcome of the grand jury decision. If he's not indicted, then it's guess good. What can happen? Yeah, yeah.
It's a good point,
because if he's
folks.
Not indicted, then he can show up at this case he got his award at, and he could testify like Officer Darren Wilson, the decorated cop that he was before he shot and killed Mike Brown Jr. But if he is indicted, that whole thing changes. And they're the ones that steer it, whether it happens or it don't happen. That's your conflict of interest. And I think nobody sees that. Perhaps you guys see it now, but that's something I want to start getting out.
Wow.
So thank you so much.
How about that? So you can see what a great trial lawyer Anthony Gray is. And he also wants to appear to the reasonable among us. Some of us are getting older, but we're not so reasonable. We're still flamethrowers. And some of us want solutions. I hope that we can all agree that the death of a young man like Michael Brown or Trayvon Martin, or I could spend the rest of the night listing the many unarmed young African Americans who have been shot and killed in this country by vigilantes or police. I hope we can all agree that that's a tragedy. Horrible, horrible tragedies and shameful in our country. The question is, what are the solutions? And so I pressed myself in writing my book not only to be critical, but also to come up with the solutions, because I think that part is difficult, but I think it can be done. And one of them I just touched on briefly with Police Chief Runge, and that is cameras. For God's sakes, why in the 20th century are we still, 21st century, are we still using 20th century investigative techniques? Why are people going around and having to interview witnesses and having to match things up and having to use a tape measure and trying to reconstruct when we have video cameras? I have one on my phone, I have one on my iPad. I think I have three on me right now, okay? Probably in this audience, there's thousands of them. All right, why every police officer in this country does not have a badge cam, a camera on the badge, tiny camera on the badge, and a dash cam is beyond me. And I know that in the city of Rialto, California, where they have badge cams and dash cams, excessive force complaints against police have dropped 80%. Isn't that a fabulous thing? And so what that means is good cops get fewer false complaints. I think everybody behaves a little better when they're on camera, so I think they behave a little better. And when there is a problem, it's documented. We don't have to go around and try to reconstruct it and try to figure out what happened and try to match up witness statements. That is old school. So I would hope that that's something we can all agree on. And I had the privilege today of meeting with some of the Ferguson activists who told me, and this was news to me, that although there are cameras now that have been given to the Ferguson Police Department, they are not being used. What? What? All right, so I'd like to ask the panel what you think about cameras and, in general, solutions so that, you know, after the fact, once we're in the criminal justice system, once somebody is deceased, it's too late. We need to stop these from happening in the future. What are the solutions? Maybe we'll go in reverse order. Anthony, how about you?
I think very quickly, I think you just stated it perfectly. cameras make people behave differently. So I just think overall they're just an excellent idea for that purpose and for all the other common sense reasons that you would think to have them. So I'm all in favor of that.
Thank you.
Lisa, I want to, actually I feel so prepared for your question, but I want to touch on something that Anthony mentioned where he said that he was trying to appeal to the reasonable-minded people. I always think that at community events, we often bring out those reasonable people and people who are like-minded to ourselves. I also think when we look at issues like this, we have to look at, quote-unquote, say, the other side. And I know there are many people in communities where there's protests going on who say, well, I sympathize with them, but I'm a law and order person. I don't go for this. I don't like it when they demonstrate at the symphony or different places. And I just want to say that if you're a law and order person, you should be 100% in favor of finding the truth about Michael Brown under the Equal Protection Clause of our Constitution. And when it comes to the cameras, addressing specifically people who might be a little more on the conservative side, one of the biggest objections to cameras is that the cost. You know, it costs a lot of money for cities and towns to equip their officers. So I just want to run down a few figures. You know, in the last decade, Chicago paid out $500 million in settlements for allegations of police brutality.
Wow.
Los Angeles, in 2011, $54 million. Denver, $13 million over a decade. Minneapolis, $21 million since 2003. And I could go on, but that pretty much to me negates the cost option. We are paying that money, and to anyone who's on the sidelines thinking, this isn't really my issue, if you're a taxpayer, this is your issue because you are paying these settlements.
Yeah. Well said. Thank you, Raul. Steve?
I agree fully with cameras. Unfortunately, one of the problems with law enforcement is we always seem to be playing catch up. We're behind the curve. Well, like Lisa pointed, I've got a camera on my phone. My 8-year-old knows how to use a camera. He's probably texting me right now. There is technology out there. On the budgetary side, the fiscal side of law enforcement, I think we have to find money for this. As Raul said, you know, they do cost money. And these are your tax dollars, and I think it's a very wise use. I am a member of a chief's organization here in St. Louis County. We support the use of cameras. We're demoing some cameras right now, and I think you're going to see a very widespread use in the near future.
Okay, good. Glad to hear that. Karen.
I have something, not cameras, sorry. In Missouri, in order to maintain license as a police officer, under the Department of Public Safety, Peace Officer Standards and Training, known as POST, officers need to complete 48 hours of continuing education every 3 years. Currently, under the state's racial profiling statute, which was passed in 2000, so that's a long time ago, officers are required to complete 3 hours every 3 years of racial profiling training. Hmm. Coming in the great self-interest of being somebody who promotes anti-bias training, that's just not enough time.
I hope that's so, anti-racial
anti-bias
profiling training.
Anti-bias. Well, you know, I mean, nowadays the industry, the policing industry calls it fair and impartial policing. Some folks use the word bias-free. Language matters in all of this. Racial profiling is tough for police officers as a phrase because for them it's a negative and it puts them on the defensive right off the bat. I get that. Criminal profiling is actually what policing does in order to catch criminals. So the language tends to be pretty subtle. Would folks in the advocacy accept going to fair and impartial? That's really what you're trying to teach people. Frankly, not just police officers, but everybody. That said, I have a goal of trying to pass a bill to amend the state's profiling statute to vastly increase the number of training hours, to mandate the creation of, get the politicians, by the way, you guys are really part of this because you vote and the politicians will listen to you because the public officials are going to be a huge part of this, to mandate the creation of what are called community law enforcement partnerships. And while that happens informally in some communities, it certainly does not happen formally statewide. And so that will be mandated so that even on a quarterly basis, if not more, policing and the community leadership will have to sit down and get to know each other, which is a huge part of what policing should be. Because to the extent that something does hit the fan, When people know each other, they can sit down and talk, and they can work it out. It may not be a perfect solution, but they can at least give it a try to do that for the benefit of the community. Mm. And there are other pieces to that. So if I could see change in Missouri, it would be to really vastly improve that statute.
Yeah, and I want to give a shout out to the ADL, the Anti-Defamation League, Karen's organization, a group that I love, of which I am a proud member, and which does work all over the country regarding anti-bias, and it's such important, often unheralded work, so thank you for that. I want to say also about cameras and recording devices. People always say to me, oh, they're just going to have it turned off, right? Or they're going to say the battery died. In fact, I have two excessive force cases right now that I'm handling as an attorney in my law firm. And don't you know, magically, in both of those cases, the recording device in the officer's pocket, the batteries were dead that day. Allegedly. My feeling is that's very simple. Part of the officer's job is checking the equipment at the beginning of the shift. If your equipment is not working, you get equipment that is working. And if you are not capable of managing the equipment, you know, maybe you get a warning the first time, the second time you're fired. That's it. That's part of your job. And I think that magically, those working batteries are going to find their way into the recording devices, and we're going to remember to turn the devices on. So please, that doesn't get anywhere. I also want to talk about racial diversity on police forces, because I think one of the issues that just catapulted the Ferguson story to national and even international attention are the terrible numbers of the police force being about 2 or 3 African Americans and a police force of over 50 in a community that's majority African American. And how on earth can that happen? I know that in my organization, my law firm, you know, racial diversity is something that we think about when we're hiring. I think that's something that most companies and organizations think about, that you want to reflect the community roughly. It doesn't have to be exact, but roughly. I mean, this isn't even anywhere close. So I guess the question I have to the panel is, first of all, how is it possible in 2014 that those numbers exist in Ferguson? And what can we do to improve the issue of, so that I believe every police force in America should reflect the community that it serves? Who wants to start?
You want to start then, don't you? You want to
I'll be more than happy
okay.
to. As a law enforcement administrator, both here and then I was a police chief out a little farther west for a while, when we hire somebody, I was telling Raul, because the same thing came up. And first of all, I agree with you. I think it's crazy that that department doesn't match its community a little closer, maybe even a lot closer. But I will tell you that one of the things that I started doing in my city is my hiring process consists of people from my town. There's an officer, Harivnik. Come on in here, Michelle. She's hiding in the wings. Say hi, everybody.
Way to put her on the spot.
She was part of that process where we brought in a resident. We have a low-income housing area. We brought in a resident from there. She didn't know anything about law enforcement other than what she might have seen on the news. She was African-American. I brought in a business owner, brought in an alderman, and we brought in somebody else to interview the applicants. And it was the recommendation from the community that made the recommendation to hire Michelle, and what a good job. And she's done a great job.
Congratulations, Michelle.
But, and the people in the community had never been a part of that. And I asked them after the process, because we had probably 5 or 6 applicants that made it through that process. And I said, what are your thoughts? And they gave such a candid response for each of the applicants that came before us. Some were African-American, some were Caucasian. She was the only female that applied. But their response was so candid. They were able to read, like, as police officers, we were micro, thinking about this applicant and that applicant. But the people from the community just looked at me and said, no, no, yes, and no. And we went with their decision. And I think that's something that's out of the box that law enforcement doesn't currently do. I invite the community to be a part of us, and it works.
I have to agree with that. I think policing in some ways is not any different than any business. And for the folks who say we cannot find qualified fill in the minority blank applicant, then I don't think they're looking in the right places. I do think that the challenge is that it frankly takes a lot more legwork I do think it may cost more administratively. I think if you look for those young students particularly, and literally, I mean, it's sort of like mentor them and hold their hands all the way through, especially for those institutions that require more education or specific academies or specific tech work. And frankly, that mentoring process at the same time ends up breaking down biases about what that profession is all about, and people will come to understand, because word of mouth is pretty powerful, that there is something there. And frankly, in this economy, for people who need jobs, the idea that there are businesses and police departments who have trouble hiring qualified minority candidates, it's a bit of a stretch. So I think the thinking out of the box piece that the chief has put on the table is good for everybody.
I think I'm thinking back to what for me is back in the day. There's some people here maybe were not alive when this happened, but I grew up in Los Angeles, and I remember very well the Rodney King beating and the changes that that brought about in the LAPD, the whole police, the entire police force. But what many people may not realize is that the Rodney King beating and the whole controversy that erupted in its aftermath, that did not change the LAPD. That happened in 1992. Things didn't really start to change in the LAPD until 1998, when there was another scandal in which the police were found to be basically operating almost like a type of cartel, running drugs, profiling, beating people, all sorts of, it was something out of a movie that it was so outrageous. Mm-hmm. And it took that for the LAPD to change, and the way it changed, for better or worse, the LAPD went through a period, it was either 6 years or 8 years, of federal oversight. They had all these years to get it together in a community with significant Latino, African American, and Asian populations, and they could not. And finally, the federal government came in and forced some of the changes on them. And there was tremendous pushback from the police. Not that things are perfect today, but the LAPD of today is so different from back then. The LAPD today, the police force, is majority Hispanic. It's 43% Hispanic, I believe about one-third white, 20% African American, which is almost a reversal of what it was before. So I'm encouraged that it can be done, that even a large police force can come to represent the community. But what always comes back to me, and this is what's so disturbing, is at what cost? Why do we have to have a Rodney King? Why do we have to have a Michael Brown? Why does, we could talk about it in the abstract, but if it's your child, you know, if it's someone that you know or are personally close to, why does it take that to bring about these fundamental changes? I think we can do better, but I don't think that it has to be at the cost of our young people losing a life for us to wake up and for our police force to recognize and come together and institute these changes.
I would say, Lisa, to add to that, I think trying to diversify police departments is a very delicate balancing act. And I say that because what departments often look for in recruits, especially in African Americans, they look for perfect people. And, you know, and most of the African Americans, yeah, I receive that. And, you know, because most of us that have grown up, like myself, born and raised in St. Louis, in one of the hottest crime areas in the city, we're going to have some blemishes. And they utilize that to disqualify you at the beginning.
That's one of the
as though somehow you can't be reformed. And I take my military experience, I remember when I was on that bus, and those were guys with real long hair, real short hair. We all look differently. And some of us come from some real checkerboard passes. But when we got off that bus and they shaved everybody's head and put us through 16 weeks of training, we were all shining like new money, ready to lay our life on the line for this country. The police department, they can't really, you know, they can't really take that chance, but they should, because here's the thing, this is the way I see it. A lot of the people that they're hiring, especially in these urban communities, are inherently disqualified to serve in those communities. They have no clue. None. They're not qualified, but they won't get disqualified because they don't have a driving while suspended. They wasn't arrested for a bench warrant. So they got the clean records, but they got messed up minds. And what they do, they put on these blue uniforms. Yeah, and I know some of these guys, I work with them. And I've actually joked with some of them and say, you don't see a blue uniform when you put it on, you see camouflage. You see a camouflage, you coming out here to hunt. You're not coming out here to protect and serve. And you can see it in the way they police. Darren Wilson is an example of it. You could just look at the way, the style of his police and the way he talked to those guys, if it's true. Get the F out of the street and all that. Now you can say that, but you better have a relationship with the people you're talking about and you talking to. Because I could have very well said it to him, but I would have been at his house the week before. I would know his mother and his father. If he didn't get out the street fast enough, I'd say, now don't make me have to go over to your grandmother's house. But they're not trying to have that relationship. And so you got these inherently disqualified people policing in a place like Ferguson, and they claim they can't find African Americans. They want them to be perfect, and they're not going to be perfect. And I guess the question becomes, when you balance it, do you take an imperfect person who, if they make a mistake, their imperfections is going to be the whole reason why they shouldn't have been hired in the first place? So it's a serious balancing act, but something needs to happen. And I went out, I was at a barber shop right after this happened, and I was talking with a barber. God, you know, he was talking about the police and profile. So I asked him, I said, why don't you join the academy? And I could tell it was something that just blew his mind. When I said, why don't you become a police officer? You know what he told me? I got driving while suspended, and I've had some bench warrants. They probably wouldn't take me. And here's a guy who didn't say, because I didn't want to be a police officer, I don't want to serve my community. He's so concerned about this background thing that it deterred him. And so I think a lot of young people just feel like, hey, they're not going to take me anyway.
Given what Anthony says, Chief, is there a place for that kind of shift in how police...
I think he's right on the money. Yeah. I don't want Jesus Christ in a police car. I want somebody in a police car that gets it, that's not perfect. I want somebody that understands and appreciates a second chance. That's where the value is. There's no value in somebody that's so squeaky clean they make noise when they walk. There's no value there. I mean, there really and truly isn't. And granted, the state of Missouri has some limitations on who they will certify. Some people screw up, and they screw up pretty bad. I get it. Okay, but the only thing we ask in law enforcement, I spoke with Rena with the Diversity Awareness Partnership, and I will go anywhere in any community to recruit. I don't want perfect, but I do need honest. I do need honesty.
Thank you, Steve.
So I will go anywhere to teach. Don't when these guys drop off applications with, I had a fella, he's African American, I just hired him yesterday as a reserve officer, and hopefully we can bring him on full time. But he's been about 3 or 4 different police departments. And his application, he had a bankruptcy, he had an assault, his wife got into it, which was, it was thrown out. He had some issues, and you know what? He was honest with me. I can deal with mistakes, but I got to have honesty. So that's what for anybody interested, has a friend and I've recruited, I'd love to have those applicants. You have to be honest with me. And that's where it all begins.
Thank you. So let me jump in with the last question for the panel before, I'm keeping a close eye on the time because I want to leave a lot of time for Q&A, because I'm sure y'all have a lot of thoughts. So for the last question, I'd like to take it away from the legal and even the policy questions and talk about the pain. As I mentioned, I met with some of the activists from Ferguson this afternoon, young people who have been out in the streets, very energized, and they talked to me very candidly about the trauma that they have felt since Mike Brown's shooting, the pain. We heard from a rabbi just before the event tonight who said the community has not had a chance to mourn. Mm-hmm. How do we work through that pain? What do we do with that pain? How do we respect that pain?
Well, this is not a town that feels emotionally things openly very well. Mm-hmm. I apologize if I offend anybody by saying that. So the idea of publicly and in a community-wide way, while we're still waiting for the other shoe to drop, is a tough gig for everybody. I would really love to call on the leadership in this town, who, and leadership in business, in education, and not just in policing, in political leadership, to talk to us about what they are feeling. And I know that everybody's talking. Everybody knows that there are conversations all over the place, right? We do that. We silo ourselves into this. The educators are talking, and the police are talking, and the public officials are talking. I know the mayors, some of the mayors of the North County municipalities in particular are talking, but nobody's sharing anything about what they're saying. And I think if there was some sense that all of these massive conversations all over the place were actually really good, that there were good ideas coming out that could be shared, that there could be some transparency to positive movement forward and real substantive long-term change here, then I think that might help the morning, because at some point, I know it's kind of trite, people talk about the healing process. We've got to get there at some point. We've got to be able to take what Anthony says are all the spectacular resources in this town and marshal them together. And if that would be my plea, it would be for the positivism that I know can come out of this community to start lifting up all of us.
Thank you.
Okay.
Payne, I lost my wife a year and a half ago due to a wrong-way driver. I lost my best friend 2 months after that.
I'm sorry.
I go to work every day trying to remember to update my will. I've got 5 kids. My 8-year-old tells me, first of all, he says, Dad, when do I get to see Mom again? And he goes, Dad, if you pass away, I won't have anybody and I'll be homeless. Don't go to Ferguson. Don't go out there. I get it. I live in that town. My son goes to the Ferguson-Florissant School District. I get it. I know the pain. I've seen the people up there crying and holding each other. I've had people latch onto me. We want change, and Anthony, you were so right. This is the city to do it. I really, truly think it is. So I get the pain. I agree with Raul. We've got to wait for the second shoe. I hope we survive this as a community. I think we will come out stronger. I thank God that nobody else has lost their life through all the riots. I'm thankful for the peaceful protests and for these forums where we can meet and have these discussions. So I think we need to work through this pain together as a community and get out the other side and look back and make those changes where lessons have been learned. And then, like Raul said also, is do some things without something happening. Do the right thing to begin with. So that's where I'm at. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Speaking on the emotional level, I remember when I was with a production group at MSNBC, and we had covered some of the Trayvon Martin case, and we were planning different things in our coverage, cases that we were anticipating verdicts and things that were on our radar, and there was some confusion about a particular date or a particular program that we had all done, and someone said, "Remember, it was that case where the police shot that young black guy." And someone else said, "Which one?" And they were totally serious. And, you know, there's a part of me, I'm honored to be here in this type of form in your community with you, Lisa. This is a wonderful opportunity for me just to be here, be part of this community. But to be honest, there's a part of me, I hate it. Because I hate that we keep repeating these same types of cycles of brutality and violence, soul searching, trials, trying to come together, and then it fades away until it happens again. And I feel like it's hard to stay positive when you remember, maybe it's not your child, but it's somebody's child. And so I really struggle with it. But I think if I could offer anything, maybe in terms of some type of advice to people, I would just say, hang on to the emotion, whether it's anger and rage or great sorrow that's gonna push you and keep asking questions of your leaders, your law enforcement, or if that's gonna make you leave work early to go to a protest, or whether that's just going to make you keep coming out to forums like this and trying to talk with your friends and neighbors about these types of incidents that should never happen in the United States of America in 2014, hang on to the emotion. Because once we start shutting it down and becoming desensitized, it makes it worse. So as unpleasant as it all is, we've got to stay in touch with that.
Thank you, Raul.
I want to thank you, Raul, because you've given me some thoughts to really comment about that, because I was kind of stumped there for a minute. But I think it's going to take what we said in the beginning, the reasonable-minded, to really be more vocal about this situation. And those people that have the most logical, and because here's what I mean by reasonable-minded. We all can agree. I don't think nobody in this room would disagree. If you lose a loved one, you're going to grieve. Isn't that reasonable? That makes sense. But there are some that don't feel this way about Leslie McSpadden and Michael Brown Sr. There are people that said that he deserved to die. Oof. They don't deserve to grieve. And that's the kind of voices they need to hear, the voices of the reasonable mind. You may not ever change them, but I would just love to see the streets and the airways flooded with reasonable-minded people. And we just don't have enough of that out there. And so one of the things that the rabbi mentioned, we haven't had a chance to mourn. I think one place we started just by acknowledging the fact we haven't had a chance to mourn. Just start there. I don't know if that's ever going to happen in the very near future, but it does need to happen. And I'm just hoping that when it does, we can all be reasonable and allow this family to mourn just like you would about the loss of your own family member. I was thinking about Jeffrey Dahmer. Now, you guys are like, what does Jeffrey Dahmer have to do with this? Now, you know, everybody knows Jeffrey Dahmer ate people. Cut them up, put them in the freezer. But guess what? His mother and father was in that courtroom pleading for his life. And I understood that. If you let them talk, my son just had an eating disorder. He wasn't a murderer. So all I'm getting at is that you allow those people to grieve. And I felt, I had strong feelings about the guy. But everybody has somebody that loves them. So I just think us folks, and I know it sounds, but I just think we all should be reasonable in the way we analyze these situations. And lastly, I'm going to say this because I want to speak to your study. And when you were talking about the races, and it kind of hit me again, you know, by and large, I'm going to make a statement you guys may or may not agree with me. This is Anthony Gray. This is from the book of Anthony Gray. No other book. I believe that Caucasian people, by and large, see the world from the top down. And African Americans, we see it from the bottom up. That's why you often hear in our communities, we're going to make a come up and we're going to get out of it. And so I think that really plays into this study, because when you're on the bottom and you look up, look who you see. Mm. You see Caucasians. Mm. They're on the top. They're running the Fortune 500 companies. They're in control of government by and large, and they're running the world. This is their country in a sense. You have some of them that will tell you that. They're the supreme beings of this country. And when they look down, look who they see. They see black people. We're the ones that loading up the bottom with poverty and, you know, and all the other little social categories that make us down there. By and large, I know some of us creep through that thing and we swim to the top and we right there with you. And that's why you see some of us that want to move out the community and we'll run out to St. Charles and we'll run out there to West County. Okay, I'm guilty. I done it. I live in West County. So hey, how y'all doing out there? So I'm just saying the way we see the world inherently and the way we born into it, my father was a firefighter. Right, my mother, you know, my father raised his three boys, got a story about that, but he ended up raising three sons. He couldn't afford nothing. So yeah, I see the world from the bottom up. And so all of us at that bottom, that's why you see so much of African Americans in large percentages agreeing with each other, because we all down here together. So our views are gonna almost be, you know, monogamous. We gonna see it the same way. And that's why when I see these studies about Darren Wilson, you got all these, because they see it. They all up here. They see it the same way. And we got this big old gulf between us. And the only person that can draw these two sides together are those that are in the middle, reasonable-minded people, pulling those up, those down, getting right in the middle and seeing it in a reasonable way.
Anthony Gray's view of the world. So I want to open this up for questions. I know that we have a lovely person, Alex, is that you, with the microphone, and we also are doing some on cards.
Yes,
right?
Indeed.
But first, I just want to really thank our panelists. I mean, I've done a lot of panels. You really spoke from the heart with great candor, more so than you usually see at something like this, and I'm just very moved, so I want to thank you all for that. It reminds me of one of my favorite quotes from an ancient Greek philosopher, which is, "Be kind, for everyone is fighting a great battle." Mm-hmm. And sometimes we don't know the battles that other people are fighting. Questions?
Well, we have watchers actually in other rooms that have sent their cards along. So I'm going to start with them and then move into the house. And I see question in the front, Aaron. What do you think about safety guns? The NRA is against them, but they could save lives.
I don't know what
You mean with the safe? Well, we don't have the person, but the safety lock, is that what we're talking about?
A safety lock?
We may not have the person for the panel for that.
A technologically advanced electronic gun.
Around them. Chris Hayes did a whole show on it. It has to be within 10 inches of the gun or the gun won't fire. And so any type of situation where police officers say they were struggling for a gun, then you better say, why don't you just do this?
Okay.
Okay.
Well, generally anything that Chris Hayes is in favor of, I'm in favor of.
MSNBC.
I do like that Chris Hayes. Go ahead.
Excuse me, I had that question. I can explain the safety gun. A safety gun is a gun that, in order for it to fire, I guess you could also call it a smart gun. In order for it to fire, you have to have a wristwatch. And so the gun won't fire unless you have the wristwatch. So it's like,
somebody else get it.
So somebody can't steal your gun. And shoot you, or somebody also, you can't shoot the gun.
Let me show you. So the officer's gun can't be turned on him.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And you can't shoot the gun, like, you have to shoot the gun like this. If you shoot the gun just with one hand, it won't fire.
Okay.
I can tell you from a law enforcement perspective, a lot of police officers are actually killed with their own weapon.
Right.
And I think anything that would further the safety, I think it's certainly worth a shot. I'm all for it.
Thank you.
One more from our audience who's in the other room, and then we're moving to in-house. There's a question about language with the protests being riots. They were asking for clarification because all of the protests were not violent.
And I want to jump in on that. I'm so glad somebody raised that. You know, overwhelmingly, we've had peaceful demonstrations, and so the appropriate term is demonstration or protest. Mm-hmm. And my personal view is history-making peaceful demonstrations that are in the long line of the great American tradition, from the abolitionist movement to the suffrage movement to the civil rights movement of the 1950s and 60s to today in Ferguson. And, you know, occasionally in any movement there are some bad apples, but let's talk about the majority, the overwhelming majority, who are peaceful protesters and not call them riots.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I think we also have to remember that that's what we love about democracy. And that's what's supposed to set us apart from other places in the world. We sometimes forget that. The Walmart protest, which was kind of remarkable, the symphony protest, which was, I mean, out-of-the-box thinking is really kind of cool and educates a whole bunch of people who otherwise wouldn't have been available to those folks.
Mm-hmm. All right, a question.
We have a question in the back.
Then we're moving to the front section.
Hi.
Hi, Netta.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm Janetta. I'm a protester, a peaceful protester. So my question is to the police chief and anyone else who wants to comment. You said the police force seems to be behind the time on technology. But as a civilian and a St. Louis resident, I've been in Ferguson since August 9th, since the shooting of Mike Brown, for the past 60 plus days. I've witnessed tear gas, tanks, pepper spray, military-grade weapons like sniper rifles, submachines, drones, yet we are behind the times. That seems like an excuse. How is the police force behind the time when they are up to date and what seems to almost be like to me as a regular person who doesn't know anything about guns? It seems very futuristic, almost like something like a movie. So how exactly are we behind the times when there are things like a safety gun that are available?
I do agree with you, and it was very movie-like that night. And what I mean by behind the times,
I'm not speaking about one particular night. I'm talking about 3 weeks worth of police excessive force on a peaceful community that was grieving. That's what I'm asking about. For 3 straight weeks, 21 plus days, I was shot. I have been tear gassed 4 times, and one being on audio. So it's not just one night. I'm speaking about 3 consecutive weeks of police terrorizing a neighborhood.
Okay.
Well, again, I cannot speak, and I'm not going to speak on behalf of the Unified Command that made the decisions to deploy the tactics that they deployed. I will tell you that these were unprecedented events. I know we all know that. How many of you were glued that Sunday night, which was a riot, that Sunday night till 2, 3, 4 in the morning as stores and places? Pardon me?
I was there Sunday night.
Oh, I was there. I was getting shot at that night. Anyway, I don't want to argue. The thing is, what I meant by antiquated tactics by the police is we learned from all of that. Those vehicles were hand-me-down vehicles from the military. That's out of date.
I think the concern is not that they're out of date. It's the over-militarization. It's what we saw, what I saw from afar on television cameras of police training loaded weapons on peaceful protesters, which everyone agrees is inappropriate.
Right. And I think, thank you. Those were probably the most important lessons learned. And I know you can scoff at that, but those were lessons learned by law enforcement officers. And that's why some of the protests, and I'm not going to go into details, but I'll take Clayton as an example. There was a lot of communication between the police and the protesters leading up to the event, during the event, and after the event that made that a very peaceful protest. There's a lot of things that happened behind the scenes. And there's not a lot of things that I could talk about to that, but I can tell you that that's why that particular protest went so well. There was a protest the other night in Webster Groves, probably didn't even make the news. I was at a protest yesterday at UMSL, that didn't make the news either. So we have learned, we are evolving in law enforcement not to escalate things.
Right, right. And Lisa, look, can I jump in right quick? Because
sure,
I think it's important.
Sure, and we have a hand waving
right,
over there.
For those that don't know, and I was there day one, probably the same 3 weeks that young lady was down there. I think it's important, we talked about truth earlier. The sequence of events they're very rarely described accurately. Because I could tell you right now, there was none of this rock throwing, bottle throwing, until the police engaged that crowd. I was there and I saw it. You will not have one incident where it was the protesters saw police officers standing there and all of a sudden they start putting hands on them. That never happened. For the record, anybody got proof otherwise? Now it's amazing, one rock hits 100 cops. You get one Molotov cocktail supposedly that hits everybody that's out there. Because every cop I know, and I got friends in law enforcement, and we take issue. We argue all the time. Okay, so you got the bottle. And the next guy told you got the bottle. Well, there's only 2 of them thrown. So give me a break. And I'm going to tell you something else. The real bad night that they had that went all the way up to Ferguson, West Florissant, and Chambers, they would have never been there had they not have led them out of Ferguson. They pushed them out of Ferguson, pushed all those people down West Florida, so they start looting all the way down. As far as I'm concerned, we're responsible for that. Law enforcement is responsible for that collateral damage that happened that night, because it never should have got to Delwood. That quick trip burned down, those of us that were there, it happened when the pandemonium broke out. When you start getting gas and all this, of course, in the all this cloud in the air and all this pandemonium, people took advantage of it. Mm-hmm. People took advantage of it. If you start clouding up this room, you probably get some little opportunity thief that might pick up a purse in the middle of it. And then you say, oh, it was a bunch of stealing going on and all people were stealing everything they saw. Yeah, but you made it gassy and cloudy in here first. So I just think sequence is so important, because every time I would see it on the news, yeah, rooting took place, it was gunfire and shooting. I was like, yeah, but that's interesting. It never started until they kicked it off. Now, correct me, anybody in this audience, I am open to be corrected. Now, if anybody else got another historical account of that, please share it with the crowd and we can go from there.
Yeah, and I think the problem that most of us observing this had was that the community is out demonstrating against the excessive force used by Darren Wilson. And in response, the Ferguson PD comes back with excessive force. There's a question over there.
Okay, I can confirm the sequence of events. I've actually been curious why police decided to attack the peaceful march with their dogs an hour and a half before looting ever occurred, and why they decided to block West Florissant and stand there in tear gas masks an hour before any looting. I have them on video in their tear gas masks. There's a media narrative that they only escalated after the looting. That is a lie. And St. Louis County did not get their Bearcat armored vehicles from the 1033 program. They bought them directly from Lenco Armor. They told me on Facebook. That is county money that paid for those.
Wow. Thank you. Let's just get a few more questions.
Recently, the governor of Illinois made it illegal for police officers to use quotas in ticketing for their promotions and retention. And I tried to find out if that was something that happened in Missouri. I was unable to find that out. So are quotas needed for policemen to be retained and promoted here in Missouri?
The only thing that I know with regard to, I guess, most meaningful change with regard to that is the fact that police departments in the state of Missouri can only retain 30% of ticket fines. Does that make sense? But I'm going to answer your question. So police officers are not under this pressure to write the amount of tickets that they used to be able to, under the pressure to write. There's no secret that some police departments, not only in Missouri, but across the state and the nation, only exist on ticket revenue. That's not a secret. I don't measure my officers by ticket productivity, I can tell you that, but I'm not gonna speak on behalf of the other 90 plus departments in St. Louis County. No, for me, it's a no. I gave you the statute. Remember the smaller departments where you drove through all the time, you know those. What I'm saying is some of those departments that lived off of ticket revenue can no longer do that. So they've simply either gone away or they've changed focus. And so those departments that forced their officers in any way, shape, or form to produce X amount of tickets, there's no need to do that anymore.
I don't know that there's a centralized location for that kind of information. What I have heard is that there are a number of different jurisdictions, and it's not just the police chiefs, but the city managers and the mayors are looking at all the different ways in which they can change the way in which they pull in revenue. So it's not just tickets, it's the outstanding warrants, it's other fees and fines that go into it, and everybody's got a different structure. So I'd like to say there's a centralized place for it, but I don't think there is.
And Aaron, I believe you have the next question.
Hi, it might be quite apparent I'm not from St. Louis. I'm visiting from England. And just more of a comment about the inherent racial bias that appears to be sort of quite across the board. I was lucky enough to, on Monday night, attend the Mother to Mother Q&A session hosted here at the museum. And something that really came across, in my group anyway, was that there's a lot of standardized tests imposed in schools, in jury selection, and one of the key questions asked is, how do you feel about the police? Now, this is something we don't have in England. For us, the idea of when you're tried by a jury of your peers, yes, we have jury selection questions, but that isn't one of them. Mm-hmm. And I'm just confused as to why is that so such an important part, because I get the impression that that will automatically filter out anyone who has any mistrust in the police because of their own experiences. So
if they admit it.
If, yeah. but if people are being honest.
Right.
If.
Well, which many people have a tendency of being.
Thank you for that question. Let me just disabuse anyone who thinks that African Americans in America get a jury of their peers. They don't. Because in most states, anyone with a felony conviction is banned from jury duty, often for life. And so in many places, that's one-third of African-American men. In Georgia, it's half of African-American men. Doesn't matter if that's a 30-year-old conviction. Doesn't matter if you've served in the military. Doesn't matter if it's for marijuana possession. And so I know, for example, in the Zimmerman case, which I covered so closely, there were five white women, and then there was a sixth. It was only a six-person jury. The sixth person, also a woman, was someone who identifies as Hispanic / African-American. It's a little bit complicated. But I will tell you, everybody was so shocked, but really it's not shocking at all. This is very, very common. I see this in cases. I'm going to trial, as I mentioned, in an excessive force case in a couple of weeks. Gee, I really hope I could get African-Americans on my jury. My client is an African-American man who was beaten by a group of white mall cops. But I know that realistically, I probably won't. Maybe I'll get one out of the 12. And this is something we don't talk about very much. We talk about voter disenfranchisement, mm-hmm. vote people not being allowed to vote, but we don't talk about juries. For those who do get called to juries, please go. Please don't try to get out of it. Please go. And please serve on those juries. We need your voice. And please, of course, vote. Now, I grew up with a feminist mama who told me stories about women throwing themselves in front of horses and having to be force-fed for me to have the right to vote. I mean, that's a heavy guilt trip, but I voted every election of my life. And our ancestors of all different colors and different genders fought for that right to vote. Please, folks, you got to vote. You got to vote on these issues. You got to hold people accountable on these issues.
Okay. I didn't mention this in my introduction, but I do want to say that if you've been with us before, you'll have to trust me in what I'm about to say. That we draw conversations to a close for the evening, but we encourage them to continue past the evening. So I'm about to say that we're taking two more questions, and we'll also have the panelists available for one-on-one conversations afterwards. If you have been following the Missouri History Museum programming, you know that we are committed to a long-term engagement on this. We have 6 months of programming to make sure that tonight we are focused on legal aspects of it. Our next program is actually with the Urban League Young Professionals, the state of Black St. Louis. So we'll be moving it on, but the last two questions have been selected, and I'm going to go to those at this time.
Thank you. I just was wondering something that's been bugging me in the aftermath of the shooting. Can any of you address why Eric Holder stepped down and what effect that's going to have on the federal investigation?
Anybody want to jump in on that one?
I can just tell you that it has a major psychological impact. The true impact and the true reasons I cannot speak to, but I did want to just jump in and say, I think from a psychological standpoint, it has had a kind of a negative impact, because who quits right in the middle of a fight? And so for a lot of us that saw his initial presence and his initial involvement as encouraging, now see him leave out the scene, that's discouraging to a large majority of people that were uplifted initially by his involvement. So from a psychological standpoint, I think it's very negative.
You know, I'm a bit of a contrarian when it comes to Eric Holder. I think he's done some good things, but not nearly enough. Not nearly enough. When we have a culture of mass incarceration, of criminalization of the poor, when he let the Wall Street billionaires run this economy into the ground in 2008, not a single one was prosecuted criminally. Not a single one, not a single person went to jail for almost bringing down the entire world economy. So hundreds of millions of dollars were paid in civil fines. There's just enough evidence for them to be civilly responsible, but not quite enough evidence for anybody to be criminally responsible over and over and over again. And so our criminal justice system focuses on the people at the bottom for these petty bullshit things, public drunkenness, jaywalking, in the case of Eric Garner, selling a single cigarette. I mean, give me a break. Is there anybody here who hasn't ever been drunk in public? I mean, give me a break. And I mean, this got to stop because this is our America, so we got to take it back. I think we got time for one more question.
Hi, my name is Tanisha Joyce, and I teach in St. Louis. I've been teaching here for 5 years, and I love St. Louis. The reason I'm going to just give a little background on why I'm asking this question. So a student that I taught my first year of teaching in sixth grade, she actually lives in the Ferguson area, and I have been tutoring her. Actually, I haven't spoken to her since I saw her run from the tear gas in front of me. But I was so inspired by her because she said, "Miss Joyce, I feel like I'm finally doing something to make a difference." And that was the night of the peaceful protest where nothing went wrong and I saw people controlling the crowd without police force, and it was amazing. Give me a minute, because it really bothers me that I saw my kids get tear gassed. And so the night that they declared the curfew, and I was marching, and in front of me was another student that goes to my school right now. And I was like, "Why are you out here right now? You need to go home and go get some sleep." And she was like, "I know, Miss Joyce, I'm gonna go home," like she does at school. "I know, Miss Joyce, I'm gonna do my work." And so she looked at me and she marched in front of me, and I went during the protest. I've been observing because I know that things are happening so fast, so I'm just observing. So she walked in front of me, and I felt okay because it was only like 8:30 or whatever time it was before the curfew. And then we were marching, and then all of a sudden we heard a noise. And I know when you watch it on TV, you can hear what they're announcing from the trucks, "You need to disperse," but we can't hear it when we're marching, and they know we can't hear it. And my brother is also in the military, so that night, I think that was the night where the military came, so it bothered me that I had to feel like I was being threatened by a military that my brother serves in. So anyway, my student is marching in front of me. I'm observing, looking around. We hear these noises from these trucks that we don't recognize, and then all of a sudden, we hear what sounds like gunshots, and the tear gas starts flying, and I'm running, and I'm running. And even with running, it still hit me, and I wasn't even near it. So I can't imagine what my student, who was in front of me, felt. And I saw the student that I saw that I taught in sixth grade, who's now a sophomore in high school. I saw her run, and I didn't even see where she went. And I know that was the second time she had been tear gassed. So knowing how much my eyes burned, and then I think about last Thursday when the police cornered us between the Qdoba and Panera that I go to, and I just couldn't believe that I was being forced into the chaos. And I saw these blue cans, and I couldn't even read the label. I was trying to read, like, what is this called? They said it was pepper spray. It was not pepper spray. The entire right side of my face was numb, and my hand was numb all night, and it kind of shot up to my arm. Like, in my sleep, I woke up, and my arm was burning. And I was like, what the hell is this? Excuse my language, but that's like, I had all kinds of other thoughts going through my head. So I want to know if anyone on the panel or after this, if anyone in this room can tell me the long-term effects of the tear gas or whatever that SHI star T stuff was in that blue can that got on my face when I wasn't doing anything wrong. I want to know what the long-term effects of this stuff is, because if I was in pain, I can't imagine a sophomore in high school or an eighth grader. So I want to know if anybody in this room or on the panel knows the long-term effects of the tear gas or the pepper spray or whatever it is that they're using against the protesters.
Thank you for sharing that story with us. And that's what I mean about the pain. Anyone an expert on tear gas? How about in the audience? I'm sorry, I don't know the long-term effects. I wish I did.
I can answer that for my department. We don't use tear gas, and we're not trained in tear gas, so I cannot answer that. My apologies. My recommendation may be to contact the St. Louis County Police Department and ask somebody that uses it. I just don't use it.
So that's not really a good idea. I feel like this is dangerous for me to speak out and say this, so I don't think I'm going to call the police department and put myself in further danger, but
well,
thank you.
If you want to meet me afterwards, give me your information, and it'll be my pleasure to make that phone call for you.
Okay.
Lisa, would you like to go to closing comments?
Yes, let's do a brief closing comments. I know so many of you had your hands up and you wanted to say more things and we ran out of time. For me personally, I'm very active on Twitter. Just my name, Lisa Bloom. Also on Facebook, Lisa Bloom. I have a website, lisabloom.com. But really, Twitter is the place. And if you tell me you were here tonight and you have some question or comment, I will respond to you on Twitter. You have my word on that. Let's just do very brief closing comments, and I'm going to be signing books somewhere. Anthony?
I thank everybody for listening and for being a part of our brief conversation today. I know that not everybody's going to agree with me, and I hope that if you didn't, that you can at least be open and reasonable enough to accept my point of view. The one thing I want to say about the case in closing is that, Lisa, you pretty much hit it on the head in terms of the delay in the process. I want to encourage everyone to be patient, be peaceful. But I, too, don't understand how six witnesses that saw the key parts of this event have not been accepted as sufficient to make a charge. It almost seems as though they were looking for Jesus himself to witness this event. And that's just like Chief Runke said, you're not just going to find people like that. So my message is clear to everybody. Let's just be reasonable. Let's be fair with each other. Let's be right. Let's listen. Let's hear each other out. I've received some really nasty emails and some stuff that came to my office. And, that kind of, we really don't have a place with this. I'm a fair-minded guy. I'm open-minded. My clients are as well. They lost a son at 18 years old who was killed from, some say, ISIS style. Almost executed in broad daylight. On their behalf, I'm just asking people to just be reasonable in their grief. Be reasonable with me. That's black and white alike. And you know the problems of St. Louis. We've had issues all these years that I've been here, and I'm 51 years old. I've seen it so bad here where I couldn't go certain places in St. Louis County. And those that are old enough like me know exactly what I'm talking about. Right now, we have a chance to address that. Today, we have a chance to open up these wounds and deal with them. And we can be the shining example for the rest of the world and how to deal with situations like that. That's why I'm open-minded, and that's why I'm optimistic about this situation.
Lisa, real quick, to the question about the long-term effects of this tear gas or whatever the gas that it was, I know that the U.S. military does not use weapons, different projectiles, that it has not previously studied what those long-term effects and short-term effects will be. So maybe going forward, that's something that you can contact your local lawmakers saying that these types of things shouldn't be used unless we know what the long-term effects are or what exactly these gases should be, because we don't even do that when we're overseas fighting enemy combatants, so why should we be doing it here? But in closing, most of all, I want to say thank you to everyone who turned out tonight, and I especially say this as an outsider. It might even seem a little unusual to all of you here, but I'm thinking of the woman visiting from England who, with a question, the young lady, Jeanette, up top, who said she's just a regular person who's going to the protests. You're not a regular person if you're going to those protests. You are living history. You're being a part of it. So I salute all of you that you are stepping forward and trying to shape what is the narrative of your city. Every single person that I told that I was coming to St. Louis, every single person in New York and also my family in California said, oh, be careful, be really careful. Don't go out alone. That's what the country thinks of St. Louis. They think your entire city is on fire, and that's reinforced by the media. So the ultimate power to shape that narrative, it's right here. Part of it is in this room. So I salute all of you for caring enough, for asking questions, for arguing, and for showing up to protest. Because years from now, this will be, people will study Ferguson and people will talk about Ferguson just like we talk about Selma. And you want to be able to say that you were a part of it, and your grandchildren will ask where you were or what you did. So just don't lose sight of that, the arc of history. And most of all, we can't say it enough, but just rest in peace, Michael Brown.
I want to thank Lisa for coming all the way out here from L.A. and to St. Louis, Missouri. So
thank you, Lisa.
Thank you.
And I want to thank everybody out here in the audience. Give yourself a round of applause for getting off the couch and coming up here. Law enforcement isn't perfect, but when I take off this badge, I sit in the chair. The people are the police, and the police are the people. We are no different. My return to law enforcement has brought a different perspective to my city, where we don't have any John Waynes and Tackleberries and black police cars with tinted windows. I encourage those of you that leave here and attend your council meeting, share those concerns with your alderman and your mayor. If you don't like the image of your police department, you guys change it. You don't like racial profiling, join this young lady right here. She fights for a bill to address some additional concerns. And I, you know, when I offered to help the young lady about the question about the pepper spray or what's in it, I'm sincere. I don't have an axe to grind. Come to the Charlotte Police Department, I'll look it up. You know what? And maybe you'll send me a Christmas card. I'll send you one. I'm not the bad guy. Neither are you. We're all in this together. So if you guys have any questions for me after this, stop by. Otherwise, I'm at the Charlotte PD. You know where to find me. Thank you.
Amen.
Thank you. Thank you, Steve. Karen?
I just hope everybody leaves here empowered to stand up for injustice wherever you see it. It is sometimes not the easiest thing to be an ally. It is sometimes not the easiest thing to challenge people who may be perceived to have more power than you to say, hey, that's not right and it needs to change. But there is, again, so much strength here. It's a privilege to be a part of this group and to be a part of this community knowing that we can just move forward very positively. So think about as you leave, and it could be in policing, it could be in the voting process, it could be in housing, education, economic development, you name it. Find out where your strength is and be an ally for people who are suffering injustice in those areas.
Amen.
Thank you. Okay, and my very quick closing thought, for all of those who get, you know, haters on email or on Twitter, and God knows I get them, you know, I quote the great Taylor Swift, haters gonna hate. All right? We don't care about them. We do what we know is right, and you don't pay any attention to them. You just keep on going forward. Conversations are important. This is a tremendously important conversation, but I don't know about you. I'm restless for change, and I'm restless for action. And the action plan, it's not complicated. We got to stop broken windows policing, stop going after people at the bottom, stop criminalizing the poor, stop militarizing the police. We got to end racial profiling. And if you have a badge and a gun, you should be wearing a camera. That's it. Well, thank you. I love you all. I really do. Thank you. Okay, so I'm told that I'm going to be in Bixby
And apparently, who knows what Bixby is? Okay, you guys do, I don't. I'm going to be in Bixby signing books, and I'm really happy to talk to y'all. Thank you so much for coming.
All right.
It's the restaurant upstairs on the second floor.